One thing that I do kind of know about are, although maybe not as much as I should, constellations. And although I don't know them very well, certainly our ancestors knew them very well, because their existence, almost life and death, depended upon a proper understanding of the night sky, which they would see every night free of electrical glare, which plagues us all the time. And one thing you might see, for example, in the night sky would be the constellation Pisces, which is on the lower part of our diagram up here. And if you saw Pisces in the night sky about where the sun was coming up on that part of the horizon, then you know the spring was approaching. Spring was probably at hand, and it was a good time to think about planting. They would plan their years, their schedules around the stars, and they certainly knew the map of the sky far better than most of us do, because they would see it every single night, as long as the clouds weren't out, in all its stunning glory. But one thing they didn't know about or couldn't explain is what those things actually were and what makes them light up the way they do. And it is a privilege for us, living as we do in the 21st century, to be living close to the age, the early 20th century, when mankind first was able to explain what those stars actually were, and especially what makes them shine, which occurred in the early 20th century and was only possible once they began to understand atoms and the structure of atoms, which was going on and happening about the time the hero of our story today, Subrahmanyan Chandrasekhar, was born in 1910. So here we switch from Europe, where we spent our last five sessions, to India, where Chandrasekhar was born in the southern Indian city of Madras in 1910, just a few years after Einstein gave us the theory of special relativity, and a few years before he announced his theory of general relativity. So Chandrasekhar, who we'll see now, the way he looked when he was a college student, was from the beginning, as you won't be surprised to learn, a rather precocious lad. He was surrounded by books from an early age, because his family was well educated in the city of Madras, upper middle class family you might call them, and they really valued education. So among the many books they had around, besides history, philosophy, and things like that, were books upon math. And Chandrasekhar would devour these mathematical books at a young age. He was mastering conic sections and things like that, calculus when he was only about 13 years old. And when he was 17, he found a book on what they knew at the time about atomic structure and devoured that, and found to his delight that he could actually entertain this thing and understand it at the age of 17, which gave him a lot of confidence. There he was in secondary school and still able to understand what leading physicists were announcing, even though he was only a teenager at the time. Not surprisingly, he got the highest grades possible on almost everything he did all through school, especially in math, which was a subject he adored and loved throughout his life. That was his first love and his longest love. He soon decided that what he really wanted to do with his life was basic research in math, and especially physics, which became something that he adored, based as it was, especially theoretically, on math. And his family, it took a little persuading to get them to agree that he would spend his career in science. His father really wanted him to go into the Indian Civil Service, which, if you were an Indian, a native-born Indian, was a very high position indeed in British India, very prestigious position. But Chandrasekhar wanted nothing to do with that. He wanted to be a scientist. And luckily for him, he had two things going for him that allowed his family to entertain the idea and not disapprove of it completely. On the one hand, his mother supported him 100%. Mother was always behind him. She knew that's what he loved, and that's what she wanted him to do. And the other thing he had going for him was his father, his uncle. And his uncle was a really famous scientist in his own right. So science was a part of the family anyway. And that meant Chandrasekhar was, as it turned out, able to pursue his dream. But that doesn't mean everything was easy for him in India. And before we journey with him to England, which is where he'll get his start in his professional life, I wanted to share a moment that he endured at the age of 19, when he was still in Madras, just getting ready to go to England. And he was on a train trip. He went to Delhi from Madras, a long way away. And then he took the return trip, and he bought a first-class ticket. I should say that he was given a first-class ticket, because his father was in the British Civil Service, and that meant he could travel first class, under some circumstances at least. So there was Chandrasekhar. He's in a first-class carriage, and he happened to be sharing a compartment with a British couple who had also bought this first-class ticket. And there they were in the same little compartment. And he could tell right away that the British woman did not like him being there. He was Indian, they were British. And she was so annoyed that eventually she reached up and she pulled the emergency brake to stop the train, because there was Chandrasekhar, 19-year-old Indian, in the same compartment. And the conductor ran over, and she said, "This is intolerable. I can't possibly stay in the same compartment with him." She'd been giving him dirty looks the whole time, even before she made the brake go off. And Chandrasekhar said, I'm not going to move. Either you move or I'm staying right where I am. And she said, she was furious. But just to rub it in, he got up and he went to the washroom and he turned, he got a suitcase out and he took away the gray, plain, business European suit that he always wore, and he put on traditional Indian costume, and he went right back to the compartment and sat down. And that's when the woman decided that she had to move. She couldn't stand that, and they went to a second-class compartment just so they wouldn't have to be there. Chandrasekhar, by the way, you can see it here, always dressed in these business suits all his life. He wouldn't go out in public unless he was in a suit like that. And eventually, they called his color Chandra Gray. And throughout the talk today, I'll be referring to him as Chandra because that's what his friends called him. The rule was that if he was teaching you, as long as he was teaching you until you had your PhD, you were always Dr. Chandrasekhar. I had to refer to him as Dr. Chandrasekhar. But once he got your PhD, he was Chandra from then on. So we'll pretend that we all have doctorates and we'll call him Chandra through the lecture here. Well, experiences like that pile up after all. You really would get annoyed if you were somebody like Chandra. He was committed to the Indian independence movement from a young age. And when he was in Madras, still in the local college there in Madras, when he was still a teenager, he actually was part of the welcoming committee for Nehru when he visited Madras. So he was foursquare in favor of Indian independence. And he was so much in favor of it that the one academic failure that he had was he purposely failed a history class at Madras College because he was so angry that there was very little Indian history. It was mostly British history. So he purposely failed it because he had such contempt for it. But that wasn't going to affect his GPA. He still graduated with one of the highest GPAs ever in the history of the local college. And for that reason, he was given the opportunity to go to Cambridge, to Trinity College, Cambridge, to study there. Rare opportunity, extremely prestigious, the chance of a lifetime, to go to the college at Cambridge where Chandra's hero, Isaac Newton, had gone about 200 years before. Nobody was going to turn that down, but Chandra almost turned that down, and the reason was that his mother was very sick, and he feared that his mother, who had supported him all his life, was going to die, and going to die very soon, and he didn't want to leave while she was dying, but she made him go, and she said that, this is her words to Chandra, you must go, you must pursue your studies to the utmost, even though she knew how sick she was, knew she probably was never going to see him again. And she actually told her friends why she had told him that he had to go. And this is what she said, Chandra is born for the world, not for me. She knew he was special. And she knew he had to make the most of his intellect. And that's why he got on the boat eventually from Bombay, bidding farewell to his mother. And indeed, he never saw her again. She would die during his first term at Cambridge when he arrived. But this was the chance of a lifetime to go to Cambridge. The best minds in English physics were there and had been there for a long time. And among the people that were going to instruct him was a famous English physicist named Paul Dirac, one of the most famous physicists actually in the world. And he was somebody who gave us equations that expressed the movement of subatomic particles. Really, really important guy. And in his own right, a great scholar as well. So this was something that he couldn't possibly pass up. And he soon began to plunge into his studies at Cambridge with great gusto. Now, Paul Dirac, while on the subject, which was his first advisor at Cambridge, was a curious fellow, kind of a funny, interesting guy to be around. And he and Chandra would go for walks in the countryside around Cambridge. And one thing they liked to do was walk up and down this old Roman road that was there. And Dirac, the kind of guy he was, he would express his thoughts in mathematical terms and in the terms of physics. So if they were going down a little dive in the Roman road, he would turn to Chandra and he would say, we are converting potential energy into kinetic energy. And then going up, he would say, converting kinetic energy into potential energy. I think it should be the other way around, but that's the way I read it, kinetic and potential. But he was also an atheist. What?
That's correct.
Okay, good, good, good. But he was also an atheist, Paul Dirac. So even though he was one of the most famous minds in physics, when he died, the Dean of Westminster Abbey in London didn't want to put him there or commemorate him because, after all, he was an expressed atheist, just as Chandra was, for that matter. But eventually, in 1984, long after he died, they were able to commemorate him somehow. And this is a plaque you can see at Westminster Abbey, Paul Dirac. And there's his famous equation, or one of them. So you can always pay tribute to him now because eventually he was memorialized there. Great mind that he was. Now, speaking of the fate of scientists, not only did Chandra get to meet Paul Dirac, which was a great privilege, and study under him, an even greater privilege, he also managed to get to Europe. And he met Heisenberg in Berlin. He met Niels Bohr in Copenhagen, as a matter of fact. And he also got to Leningrad during the 1930s, and he met a lot of scientists who really impressed him there. And he later would, with great sorrow, talk about them, because almost all of them were either killed by Stalin or the Nazis during World War II. But a few of them did survive, and some of the best moments of his life were getting in touch with them again, those who survived the Holocaust and Stalin's tyranny, and exchanging notes with them. Those who were still a part of the Republic of Science, even though the brutality of human politics had done away with most of their friends. Now, by the time they got to Cambridge, Chandra, who was very interested in mathematics and pure physics, had also become interested in a branch of physics, which wasn't considered as prestigious as theoretical physics at the time, and that was astrophysics. And here we're talking about the construction, the nature, and the fate of stars. And in fact, and this is our moment in science for today, on the long voyage from Bombay to London, as he was just going to Cambridge, and he was only 20 years old, he had begun to think about the problem of the fate of stars, how stars, in fact, might collapse. Now here, of course, when we're talking about the fate of stars and collapsing, we're not talking about Madonna. There she is collapsing, for example. We're not talking about that kind of star. We're talking about a completely different kind of star. And what he was thinking of on the voyage to London was the fate of a star that would be far bigger than our star that gives us life, the sun. And specifically, what he was thinking of was white dwarfs, which is what our sun will eventually become. And the nature of the problem goes something like this. Now, we know that the star in all, the sun, of course, and all stars are extremely hot at their core. And our sun's degree temperature at the core, physicists always talk about Kelvin, but we can put it in Fahrenheit. I think it's something like 25 million degrees Fahrenheit at the core of the sun. What?
The unit doesn't matter at that temperature.
Doesn't really matter at temperature. We're not gonna spend much time in it anyway. Now, at these very hot temperatures at the very core of the sun or at any star, stars get to do what stars do. And stars all do, during most of their life, one main thing. And what they do, of course, is they take hydrogen and they fuse hydrogen atoms together and make the element with two protons and two electrons, and that's helium. And that's what stars do. They convert hydrogen to helium. And in that conversion, which goes all the time in the furnace of stars, some energy is lost. And that electromagnetic energy is the light and the heat that keeps all of us alive. And that's why stars shine. They fuse hydrogen atoms into helium atoms, and the excess energy comes to us and keeps us alive and lets us see everything. Well, our star, of course, being a relatively medium-sized or small kind of star, is only burning away at 25 million degrees. But if you get a much bigger star than our sun, then the temperature in the core of that star is bound to be much hotter, sometimes something like 200 million degrees or something like that. And the way it works, as we knew by the 20th century, is the bigger the star, the more massive a star, the brighter it seems to shine. So there's a relationship between mass and luminosity, which was well known, at least by the 1920s. The more energy it gives off by fusion, the larger the star, the more energy it's going to give off by fusion, and the shorter its lifespan. So the more massive the star, the more energy it gives off, the shorter its lifespan. And that was fairly well known, or at least beginning to be known, by the 1920s, when Chandra made his famous voyage from Bombay out to London. Fusion, what makes the stars shine, when hydrogen becomes helium, gives us finally the answer to what the ancients must have wondered night after night. What, after all, is creating those beautiful lights that we see in the night sky and that we depend on? And what a beautiful thing it is to know that in our own time, or in the time of our grandparents and great-grandparents, that riddle was finally figured out. How privileged we are to live at a time when we know how stars shine. Now, with our sun, the end of our star, which gives us life, is not going to be terribly dramatic. It's going to be a rather prosaic kind of ending, nothing much to brag about, nothing much to care much about. What's going to happen to our sun is that eventually, as the hydrogen begins to burn down into mostly helium, our star, our sun, is going to begin to expand and expand and expand, eventually, maybe over the course of the solar system, about 100 million miles, so that it eventually encompasses the Earth and burns that up very conveniently for those who might be there. I think most of us will be gone by then. We'll be in different parts of interstellar space by then. But that's the fate of our star. It's going to burn up and expand into a red giant. So here's a little bit of an illustration of what a red giant might look like. They're all over the place, these red giants, old stars that began much like a yellow star like our sun. And Betelgeuse, I think, is a red giant, which is a star pretty common, invisible in the night sky. And eventually, there's not going to be any power source anymore, as all the helium is made from all that hydrogen. And then, eventually, all that's going to be left when the helium is gone is a bit of carbon and oxygen, not that much bigger than the Earth. And that's our white dwarf, a rather stable, uninteresting bit of sky, which isn't going to do any good to anybody anymore. It's just going to be a nice, inoffensive bit of carbon and oxygen. And that's the white dwarf, and that's going to be what's left after the red giant burns itself out. And that's going to be about 6 billion years from now. I think it's going to be 5 billion years until we get the red giant, and then 1 billion years for the red giant, and then it's just going to be the white dwarf. So there's nothing to write home about here. That's no big deal. And that white dwarf, just it's going to be a waste of time. It's nothing to bother about. And let's just forget that white dwarf. It's contemptuous. Who cares about that white dwarf? But here's what Chandra was thinking of. That white dwarf that's left after the red giant burns itself out, is going to have an awful lot of mass in it. Awful lot of mass in just a small space, about the size of the planet Earth. And the question might be, how can something that dense with all that mass hold together? That's a really heavy, massive thing. And by this time, by at least the late 20s and early 1930s, we knew, or we had some understanding of how something that dense can cohere, can still hold together. And the way it works is something like this. And this was expressed by the great physicist Wolfgang Pauli, and I actually threw this out there during our first session, the famous Pauli exclusion principle. And the idea here is that if you've got subatomic particles, protons and electrons especially, what we know about them is that identical as they are, proton, 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 electron, 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 no electron can occupy the same space as any other electron, and they all have to be going at a different spin, that a different momentum. So in other words, no two identical subatomic particles can have the same space, occupy the same space, and have the same momentum, which means they can never be too closely packed together. They've always got to have a singular space and a singular spin to them. So what's happening is, as most of the star stuff is getting compressed and compressed into compressed into this little white dwarf the size of the Earth with all that mass that used to be the Sun, it's getting compressed and compressed and compressed. It can't compress all the way because those electrons have to move really fast to keep occupying different spaces and have different spins. So the movement of the electrons and the protons moves against the pressure coming from this way. And there's a counter pressure from all that movement given to us by the Pauli exclusion principle, which balances out the pressure coming out, that is outward, inward. And we get an equilibrium with our white dwarf, and that's why it's boring. It just stays around and does nothing. It's no use to anybody. It's just cosmic clutter. Throw it away. Forget about it. But here's what Chandrasekhar thought. That works perfectly well with a white dwarf about the size of the Earth, which is what our Sun will eventually be, that kind of white dwarf. So you got the pressure coming in the movement by the subatomic particles making pressure going out. So it's just going to stick around. But what if you had a far more massive white dwarf? What if you had a really, really big white dwarf? Now, if that happened, then all that pressure coming in with all the mass of what had been a perfectly respectable star is going to be so vast and so immense that the electrons are going to have to move really, 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 really fast to keep pressuring against it. And in fact, they're going to have to move so fast eventually that they approach the speed of light. And we know nothing can exceed the speed of light. And what eventually is going to happen is that vast movement of electrons is going to destabilize the gas. They're moving so fast, and they're never going to, at a certain point, keep up with and balance the pressure coming in. They just can't move that fast after a while. And eventually what has to happen is the gravity coming in, the compression coming in, can't be evenly balanced. And the result of that is going to be gravitational free fall. The vast force of gravity is just going to go into an uninterrupted, impossible to counter fall, maybe in as less of a space as 1 second. It's all just going to collapse. And the likely theoretical consequence of all that gravitational collapse with all that mass at the same time collapsing is some region in space so tiny and yet so massive that no light can escape from it because the gravitational pull will be so vast. In other words, theoretically, a region of space of such colossal mass at such a small space that eventually people would call it a black hole. So intense, so massive, that light itself cannot escape. A region where gravity is so strong that all other forces in the universe are overcome. Now, Chandrasekhar's great mathematical insight was to say that there's a precise spot where the white dwarf will be so big that this will happen. Far bigger than the mass or the space of a sun, which would be just our Earth as a white dwarf, he actually gave it a famous figure. 1.4 solar masses will equal the size of a white dwarf that can't cohere. It'll go into free fall. So in other words, a white dwarf 1.4 times the size of the sun can't be sustained. The Pauli exclusion principle isn't going to help to balance out the pressure, and it'll collapse into that kind of singularity. A region of space so dense and so small that light itself can't escape, what we would eventually call a black hole. So here's the way it looks via a graph. So here's our what became known as the Chandrasekhar limit, right there, 1.4 solar masses. Beyond that, we get collapse into a singularity. Before that, we have a sustainable white dwarf. This is what it looks like, I suppose, by the numbers. And this is what it looks like the way cats think of it. And if you keep eating cat biscuits at that rate, you're going to reach the Chandrasekhar limit soon. Now, he thought of this. He actually had this in his mind on that famous boat voyage. But what he really wanted to study was theoretical physics. He just loved the math more than anything else. So he didn't put this into the kind of form that could be published in its entirety. He did publish some papers at Cambridge, began to be fairly well known. But he hesitated before actually publishing these results. And the reason was that this idea that there could be something like a black hole, even though they didn't call it that yet, had been expressed or had been posed even in the late 18th century, that you could have gravity that strong that light couldn't escape. Even in the 18th century, they had proposed that idea. And Einstein's theory of general relativity would seem to suggest that as well. But nobody had ever really demonstrated that it could actually, literally happen. It was a theoretical proposition. But Chandra was showing now that this could happen based upon the size of a white dwarf, far bigger than our sun. And this is what got him into trouble. Because his idea of the fate of white dwarfs, that this could actually literally happen in the universe, was so strange that even the leading lights of English physicists refused to believe that that could actually happen. And here what I'm thinking about, or the man I'm thinking about, is the most famous of all English physicists. And there he is, Arthur Eddington, who was also at Cambridge and who worked with Chandrasekhar a great deal while he was at Cambridge, a man that almost all physicists admired enormously. He's the guy, remember, who took that ship voyage to the coast of Africa and measured the curvature of light around the sun during that eclipse, which demonstrated the truth of Einstein's theory of general relativity. And he had also done important work about why stars shine, important work on fusion. He had demonstrated the relationship of mass and luminosity. He was a very important and impressive character. Even he was also a very unusual fellow, shy to the point of it being very disturbing sometimes to be around him. Said to be one of the world's worst golfers. Sometimes he'd go lecture on California. He never wanted to play golf with him. It would take forever. He'd love to play, but it would just take forever to get over the course with him. But the thing I like about him was he, even though he was English, he was a really big baseball fan, a lover of baseball. And when he came to Boston to lecture at Harvard on the occasion of Harvard's 300th anniversary in 1936, he spent every spare hour during the day at Fenway Park at Red Sox games. So he got to see Lefty Grove pitch. He got to see Jimmy Fox in the outfield. He just loved going to America. He could play golf in a lot of places, and he could watch baseball. During World War II, actually, when he was stuck in England during the duration, he wrote friends about almost nothing except how much he missed baseball. Can't get over there. Would love to see a game. Now, he could not believe that a black hole, however likely from the standpoint of theory, could actually exist. Quantum physics suggested it might, but he said, no, this couldn't ever happen. Nevertheless, and this is where I think the bad side of his character comes in, he seemed to encourage Chandra to look into the problem further. And for years, he would keep track of what he was doing about elucidating the math behind this effect of the collapse of a white dwarf. He seemed to be encouraging. But we know now that all the time he was encouraging Chandra to maybe publish this eventually, he was actually finding ways to contest it, finding ways to oppose it. He would want to know what Chandra was thinking just so he could figure out what he was going to say against it. And we know that's true because as Chandra prepared obsessively for a talk at the Royal Astronomical Society in 1935 to express this idea of his, that you could have a white dwarf collapse into the singularity, Eddington was looking over his shoulder the whole time. And just as he was about to deliver the paper a couple days before, after Chandra had worked 12-hour days for about a month to get it in final form, Eddington happened to mention, oh, by the way, I'm going to present a paper after you. So the first Chandra heard of this. That got him kind of nervous. So here's 24-year-old Chandrasekhar from India. Stood up before the Royal Astronomical Society, delivered a paper in January 1935 expressing his mathematics regarding how this would actually work, the collapse of a white dwarf into a literal, what we would call, black hole. He gave the address, did very well, he thought, then he sat down, and then Eddington, to his surprise, not only got up to deliver his paper, but insisted at every point that Chandra had to be wrong. Point by point by point, he brought up the basic argument that Chandra was improperly and wrongly confusing what's true on the quantum level to what's true on the level that we can see, that he didn't really understand what he was talking about, and that this actually could not possibly happen because there must be some principle in stars that had to prevent the collapse of a white dwarf that size. There's got to be, Eddington said, a law of nature to prevent that. And he had equations on his side, although it turned out that they were not terribly well drawn up. And he had arguments that were based on common sense, on what people usually thought. But worst of all, he made light of Chandra. He didn't take him that seriously. He made little jokes about him. And this poor young physicist, sitting in the audience now at the table, shrinking during this withering attack, had to endure the whole thing. He felt humiliated. He felt helpless. But the worst part was what came after the speech. When people would come up to the table where Chandra was sitting and pat him on the back a little bit and say, "We're so sorry," as if they knew Chandra had to be wrong. "We're so sorry that happened. Go back to the drawing board. Maybe you'll make something of this." The worst moment of his life, hearing Eddington do that, apparently demolishing what he had come to think after that voyage and 4 years of honing about the fate of white dwarfs that size. And such was Eddington's prestige that even physicists who knew that Chandra was probably right, Dirac, Wolfgang Pauli, would not go public with their support. They didn't want to confront Eddington about this. Eddington even referred to Chandra's findings as stellar buffoonery. Used that phrase, stellar buffoonery. Now, how much of this meanness can be ascribed to the fact that Chandrasekhar was an Indian? How much of it be ascribed to convenient, usual racism? Or how much just to an idea that Eddington did not want to be shown to have not come up with something when this Indian had come up with something? Professional jealousy, whatever it was, this went beyond the bounds of simple scientific disagreement. This was mean and this was petty. And it's a sad reminder that even in the Republic of Science, personalities can intrude, and upon the altar of science, people can be sacrificed based upon vain ambition. And what it meant was Chandra could not come into his own in England. Eddington ruled the roost in England. So Chandra was going to have to leave. And in that same year, 1936, that Eddington went to Harvard to deliver that address and go to Red Sox games, in that same year, Chandra also left England, never to return on a permanent basis. He taught at Harvard for a little while, but then he got a permanent job at the Yerkes Observatory in Wisconsin on Lake Geneva, a place called Port Williams, 80 miles north, I think, of Chicago, Williams Bay, Wisconsin, 80 miles north of Chicago. And there he taught. He did what research he could. And he had the time to publish what became the standard textbook on stars and how they're constructed, The Study of Stellar Structure, to this day a standard resource. And during the war, during the 1940s, he did great service for the country at the Aberdeen Proving Grounds in Maryland for the military, the only difficulty there being that he was in Maryland and some places wouldn't serve him. Brilliant as he was, working for the war effort, he nevertheless sometimes had to go to a few restaurants before he could get a meal. And of course, as we know, he was soon vindicated. Robert Oppenheimer, among others, would do the mathematical work to show that these singularities, these regions of space of vast gravity, actually could and would happen. And not only that, but one thing I like to describe in this respect is a rediscovery of a physicist who had already done valuable work, whose equations would show that Chandrasekhar indeed had probably been right. And the man I'm thinking about here is the great Karl Schwarzschild, a German who had died in World War I of a disease contracted in the trenches. But before he died, he had demonstrated mathematically how a sphere would actually work gravitationally in curved Einsteinian space. And in doing that, he had demonstrated that every object with mass would have, if you reduce the mass to the right area, every object with mass would have its own, what is now called, Schwarzschild radius. And at that distance, at that length, every object of mass could conceivably be a black hole. So I'll show you what I mean by that in a second. This is, I might be able to get to Schwarzschild here. Maybe not. But there it is. So this is a Schwarzschild radius. And what that means is this. Imagine, for example, you take the sun. The sun has a diameter of, I think, about 860 million miles, right? So that means that it has a radius of 432 million miles. So the sun has a radius of 432 million. Now, if you take that object with all that mass, 432 million miles in radius, take the sun and shrink, you keep the mass.
Thousand.
No, million.
No, thousand. Radius of
a... Oh, you're right. 432,000 miles. So I got my zeros. I was so excited about the Schwarzschild radius. You're right. Very good. 432,000 miles. So you were looking confused, too. What? That's right. And you're right. 432,000 miles.
If it were a million, it would go all the way out to Pluto.
That's way out there. That's right. Pluto. You know that. That's not true. 432,000 miles radius. Shrink it down to an area 2 miles, and the sun would be a black hole, taking in light itself and everything in the neighborhood. So that means you and I, we could be black holes, too. But you have to shrink our mass down to the radius of a proton. So if you take all our mass, your body and my body, shrink it down to a proton, we'd be black holes. So that'd be so dense, such gravitational force in that little proton with all our mass in it, that we would actually take in light itself. So the Schwarzschild radius has those mathematical properties. And with that kind of math and other work as well, by the 1950s and especially the 1960s, Chandrasekhar's work on the possibility and the likelihood of black holes was demonstrated to be very likely true. So he was eventually vindicated, and he became one of the most famous physicists in the world. He had an international reputation at Yerkes, but he would travel to the University of Chicago twice a week to give lectures. And very famously, he was an extremely dedicated teacher. He was not the sort of guy you want during a lecture. If you start lecturing on something, he'd be one of those people who just walk out right away if he didn't think he was going to get anything out of it. And if he went 2 minutes, you know, that was going to be a bad lecture. But one guy went an entire lecture, and then Chandra left during the question and answer. And he was upset. Why is he leaving during the question and answer? Somebody said, no, he loved it. He stayed through the whole lecture. You're lucky. But as a teacher, he could be very, very supportive. And the famous story about him is that he was up in Yerkes in Wisconsin. He had to go down to Chicago to give a seminar class in which there were only 5 students. Well, the problem was there was a blizzard going on, and hardly anybody was out in the blizzard, but he insisted on driving from Wisconsin down to Chicago in the raging snowstorm to be at the seminar with only 5 students, even though he knew, as the other 4 students did as well, that one of those 5 always fell asleep anyway. But he went down there, and he got to the seminar, and there were only 2 students who showed up, but the point of the story is both of those students would eventually get Nobel Prizes. And he had about 50 graduate students working with him very, very closely during the course of his career. I think probably just about all of them did well. And he did a lot of work at Chicago with the other famous physicist there, Enrico Fermi, who was Chandra's opposite in a lot of ways. Chandra always wore a suit, never out without a suit. Fermi didn't like ties. He usually had short sleeves or sleeves rolled up. And liked to eat hot dogs, too, which Chandrasekhar didn't care much for, obviously. But the two of them were perfect collaborators because Chandra was just obsessed with math. The math always had to work out. He was never happier than when he was working with math. Fermi would usually work in great principles, and he was content often to live the math to people like Chandra. So they worked very well together at Chicago. And one of Chandra's doctoral candidates turned out to be Carl Sagan. And Carl Sagan would always say that the man who introduced him to the pure joy of mathematics was Chandrasekhar. And Sagan always remembered him and thanked him for that. Eventually, we know that Chandra got his own Nobel Prize a little bit late in 1983. And he got his Nobel Prize eventually for his work in explaining the fate of stars and for elaborating the 1.4 solar mass Chandrasekhar limit. And he was not happy about that because he'd done a lot of other work. A lot of other work heavily based upon mathematics, especially about the mathematics of black holes, which he worked out very well. And he thought he should have been recognized for that rather than this. But he took the Nobel Prize and became, therefore, a hero, not just in America where he became a citizen, but also in India, the land of his birth. So it's to his work and to the work of other astrophysicists that we owe our understanding of that phenomenon with which we began the series, all the way back more than 6 weeks ago now, when we talked about Tycho Brahe. Because remember, what was it that taught Tycho that we are all living in one universe, that the Earth is not distinct from the rest of the cosmos? And that was his observation of the great supernova of 1572, which could not be, of course, closer to the Earth than be on the moon. It had to be up there where the stars are, which meant that things in the heavens changed, which means that the heavens are just as changeable as Earth, which means we are all living in one universe, and that what is true a billion light years from here is probably true here as well. The principles of relativity hold true there as well as they hold true here. Light behaves a billion miles away, a billion light years away, much as it behaves here. And those massless photons that Einstein was so interested in, what would it be like to ride on a photon, behave many, many billions of light years away as they behave here. We are all, after all, in one universe. And what all these equations and insights now allowed us to do is to understand the fate of stars, not just the kind of white dwarf that our sun will be, but also, as we just heard, the kind of white dwarf that would be far, far bigger, 1.4 solar masses, and perhaps the most breathtaking of all phenomena in the universe, what could happen as the star, something that size, reaches its last stages before it might become a black hole. And that's where we finally get to know what that supernova is actually going to be like. So this is something about what a black hole might look at. It's just, of course, an artist's rendition. But there you see in the middle of this accretion disk, as they call it, all that dust and all that light, the black hole from which light can't escape.
Mostly.
And mostly because Hawking taught us that certain kinds of radiation can be emitted from the black hole. And this is what, of course, a supernova might look like. So let's talk about what happens there. And this is, of course, what many people consider, and what I consider, the most spectacular single event that you can have in the cosmos. And it's Chandra's equations and those like him that taught us to understand how this can actually happen. So imagine a star far more massive than our sun, which, remember, is not going to explode, but which will simply expand as a red giant harmlessly about 100 million miles away until it swallows the Earth. Maybe not that harmlessly. But if the star is something like 8 times the size of the sun, when it's done fusing all those hydrogen atoms into helium, which is what suns do, that's their business. As long as they go about their business, everything is fine, and we can go on watching TV and taking long walks and enjoying the winter and the summer and the seasons. As long as that happens, everything is fine. But if a massive star like that, 8 times the size of the sun, finishes up with all that hydrogen, the immense heat, at the core of the sun is still there to keep fusing those helium atoms into things heavier and heavier and heavier. So here's where we get to talk about the periodic table, which all of you remember from your school days. Helium, the atomic number is 2, right? Okay, so what's next? What's 3?
Lithium.
So the next one is lithium on the list. So how much does carbon have?
6,
I hope.
Six.
Yeah, so maybe. 6, that's right. So we keep fusing all those atoms into heavier and heavier elements, 2, 3, 6, eventually magnesium, 12. We're going to make magnesium in the last dying stages of the star, so vast and so hot that all those atoms can still be fused together even when we're done making, or for the time being, making all that helium. Calcium, 20 atoms. We're going to make 20 atoms, 20 protons and electrons. We're going to make calcium. And the whole time, the expiring star is releasing energy, making all these heavier and heavier elements because there's so much heat and it's so big. But eventually we get to silicon. Silicon is 25 protons and electrons. And then we're almost done, because the next one after silicon is what?
Iron.
And iron's got 26 electrons and 26 protons. We fuse all those electrons together. Now we're going to make iron. But once we get to iron, that's the end of the road. There is no more energy to be released by nuclear fusion once we get to iron. So we made all those heavy elements, but now we're at iron. And at this point, if the iron core, now we're iron, all that core is iron, or a lot of it is, if that iron core is beyond the 1.4 solar mass Chandrasekhar limit, it's too massive to stop there. It can't sustain itself as this nice iron core. So it must collapse, must keep collapsing now, into something with the density of an atomic nucleus, 1 million billion times the density of water. But here's where things get interesting. That collapse is so dramatic. It results in the emission of gravitational energy, vast amounts of it, 10 times the energy in that collapse than the star manufactured by fusion during hundreds of millions of years of existence before that. So imagine that. More energy is released now in the last dying seconds of a large star through gravitational collapse from that iron core than through 100 million years of nuclear fusion before that. It's gravitational energy that accounts for most of the energy of a massive star like that. The speed of this compression creates such force, although we don't really understand it completely, that there is a bounce back effect. against the outer core of the star, producing the great supernova explosions in the unleashing of vast amounts of subatomic particles called neutrinos throughout the universe, 100 trillion of which pass through all of your bodies in the winter of 1987 during the supernova of that year, which actually took place 170,000 years before. So if on a certain day in 1987, if you felt a bunch of neutrinos, about 100 trillion of them going through you, then that was it. It was the supernova of 1987. The incredible heat of that explosion. So it's this iron core. The incredible heat of that explosion, even higher than the normal temperatures of the core of a star, is so hot that atoms continue to be fused together in the force of that terrible explosion. And in those high temperatures, we go beyond iron. 27, 28, 30, 35, atomic numbers all the way up, so that every element in the universe is produced now, all those heavy elements in supernova explosions. And they hurtle through space, and eventually they get here, and they make you and I and everything on Earth. Everything here, everything you are, everything you see, are elements made from supernova explosions. That's how we're here, all those exploding stars. And in fact, hydrogen bombs are based upon the principle of fusion, and when they go off, like the original hydrogen bomb, which went off in the Pacific, destroyed that island out there, they created all the heavy elements in the universe right there during that exploding hydrogen bomb. Now, when these things happen, the next stage has to do with what's left. What's left after all this? And it depends how big the star was. So what could be left is a black hole, which began to be called black holes in the 1960s, places of such gravitational pull that if you were to venture near the black hole, let's say you're swimming around, now you're going towards the black hole, what's going to happen to you? Remember how strong the gravity is. It's going to stretch you out, stretch that nice big spaghetti. So eventually you're going to be one big spaghetti atom, I guess. But the idea is you're going close to the speed of light, so your mass stretches. But also, because you're going close to the speed of light, time's going to slow down, and eventually on the horizon of the black hole, essentially it will stop for you because of Einstein's theory of special relativity. Speed of light, time stands still, and you can hang out on the horizon of the black hole and look at the entire history of that region of space right in front of you, because time has stopped still for everything else too in the black hole. And there's a theory that all of us are just projections on the horizon of a black hole. That's all we are. Just holographic projections on a black hole. That might not be true, but that's at least one theory. But stars not so massive than that, and this is my favorite part of all. This is my favorite part of the heavens. They may not necessarily end in black holes. That might not be what's left after a supernova. If they're a little less massive than what I've just described, then they could end in something else, which is a coherent body with enough going on molecularly within to hold together and cohere. And those are called neutron stars. So this is our supernova explosion. And this is an artist's rendition of what a neutron star might look like. The thing I like about neutron stars is they're not very big. So your average neutron star would be maybe something like 10 miles across. So if you wanted to walk from here to Sudbury, that would be about what a neutron star would be. It's pretty small. And they're incredibly dense. So imagine all that matter in this incredibly small space left after the supernova explosion. And what's going on here at a neutron star is we don't have protons and electrons anymore at all. They're fused together into neutrons. Got all a bunch of dense neutrons all packed together and are nicely coherent in the neutron star. But what that means is an awful lot of gravity, because it's so small but so incredibly unimaginably dense. And they're so dense, what that means is if you dug out a bit of neutron star the size of a sugar cube. So you're on the neutron star, which I wouldn't advise because you've all flattened out like that. But if you're on a neutron star, if you live long enough to take a little bit of neutron star the size of a sugar cube, that would weigh on Earth 100 million tons. A little sugar cube weighs 100 million tons on Earth. Basketball would weigh even more. And if you were to try to climb a little millimeter mound on a neutron star, just a little millimeter, probably all completely nice and flat, but you could have a little millimeter on the neutron star. If you wanted to climb the millimeter, it would take as much gravitational effort as it takes for a rocket to escape the Earth's atmosphere. That's a neutron star. That's the gravitational pull that a neutron star exerts, because it's so dense and so small. The gravity exercised by a neutron star is roughly a trillion times that of Earth, so that's why you would be squashed flat if you were to tread upon a neutron star. Now, all of these miraculous, wonderful, amazing things were figured out. We owe them a debt of gratitude by the astrophysicists of the 20th century, Chandra and otherwise. And it is a happy ending to the story that Chandra lived to see his work vindicated. The not so happy ending is that he never really felt that he was recognized for his true talents, because he's always thought of by most people as an astrophysicist. But he wanted to have most of his recognition and his efforts understood in terms of theoretical physics. He loved the math. He loved the math more than anything. And he labored over it, just drove himself to the point of exhaustion over it. He loved it, and he was, in a way, perhaps obsessed by it in the way that maybe only true geniuses can be, by something they love. He wrote about all sorts of things. At the end of his life, he was hard at work, and he finally finished almost all of it, on a work that explained the Principia Mathematica, Newton's great work. Newton was always his hero, and he wanted to write a work expressing how brilliant that really was so that most of us could understand it. But he was also, strangely enough, or interestingly enough, interested in painting. And one of his last efforts was to draw up a lecture, which became a series of essays on Manet. And he actually explained Manet's recurring themes, like haystacks and churches, in terms of general relativity. It's a brilliant work, which eventually I'll try to read. And in fact, one of the last things he saw in his life was Manet. One night, he was at the family home, and I think they were in Wisconsin at the time. And he'd been having chest pains for a while. He'd had heart attacks before. Had surgery because of a bad heart. And his doctor had told him, you really need to be careful. But sometimes he'd have pains. But these pains, he woke up, and they were worse than usual. And he didn't want to wake up his wife, Lalitha, who was a big support to him all through his career. They were married over 50 years. So he let her sleep. But he got up, and he went past his dresser. We know it because of what he was dressed when he left. And the last thing he might have seen would have been a postcard of Manet, one of the churches that happened to be right on the dresser. He put on his clothes, he got in a car, and he drove to the hospital. And there, after he was admitted, the doctors told him, you're in very, very, very serious shape. I think he only lived another day, died in the hospital. His wife was able, of course, to see him at the end. He was always so well regarded at Yerkes, for example, that when he left for the University of Chicago, which he eventually did full time, they always kept his office. And for 20 years, they wouldn't let anybody take his office, because they always wanted him to come back. But now he was gone, and this is 1995. And when he died, his ashes, some of them were spread back in India, but the rest of them were spread over Lake Michigan, where he spent most of his professional life. And of course, like Giordano Bruno's ashes, after his execution in the Campo delle Flores in Rome in 1600, his ashes would never disappear. They're like everything else, remnants of exploding stars, which, because of the law of conservation of mass, don't go away. They simply change it to something else. And so it goes, and so it goes. We owe him thanks and gratitude. And I owe you thanks and gratitude for coming so often, and to the friends of the Bedford Free Public Library for getting here early and doing all that work. So thanks again. That was a lot of fun. And we'll see you soon. Thank you.